I know what you're thinking. Come on, Ian. What on earth is an ERV? To help us understand this technical subject, Dr. Jean Lightner has joined me via Skype. Dr. Lightner obtained her bachelor's degree in agriculture, earned a master's and DVM in veterinarian science, all from Ohio State University. She is an excellent communicator, and I'm thrilled to have her join me today. Welcome to the show, Dr. Lightner.
Why, thank you, Ian.
So let's start off with that question. Just what is an ERV, and how does it relate to the creation-evolution debate?
Okay. An ERV is an endogenous retrovirus. And in order to understand what that is, maybe we should talk about what a retrovirus is.
Mm-hmm.
There are several different kinds of viruses, and all pretty much contain a protein outside, and inside they have a nucleic acid, which is either DNA or RNA.
And RNA, of course, is like one half of the DNA ladder.
Essentially. Retroviruses have the RNA on the inside. When they infect a cell, the RNA is injected into the host cell. Then something very interesting happens. Usually we think of DNA as being transcribed into RNA, which is then translated into proteins. However, with the RNA from the retrovirus, it does something kind of backwards. The RNA is used as a template to make DNA, and then it becomes part of the host DNA. This is reverse transcription, which is where the retro term comes from.
Mm.
So a retrovirus is something outside a cell which infects a cell. The RNA is reverse transcribed back into DNA. Then, when the host transcribes its own DNA, it will copy the virus DNA as well, and then it'll make new viruses. And you have a whole bunch of new viruses to go off and infect other cells.
Right.
Okay, there's some specific features of a retrovirus sequence that help us identify it. For example, on either end are long terminal repeats, or LTRs. And this is repetitive DNA. And in between, there are several specific genes. Well, when we started looking at sequence data from the DNA of various creatures, such as humans and animals, we found patterns that looked like the result of retrovirus infections.
Okay.
However, these sequences are part of the DNA that's passed down from parent to offspring. It is these sequences that are called endogenous retroviruses.
Ah, okay. So now, could you briefly clarify how we know the difference between a retrovirus and an endogenous retrovirus?
Okay, with a regular retroviral infection, some of the cells in the body are infected, but those cells don't go on and pass information to the offspring. With an endogenous retroviral sequence, it appears similar to a retroviral sequence, but it's found in all the cells of the body and it's passed on to the offspring.
Okay.
Many of these sequences have patterns in them that make them look like they're damaged from an ancient infection because they don't code for all the necessary parts to make an active virus.
Okay.
And often there's many copies of them, which makes it look like it spread in the DNA in the past.
Ah, okay. Okay. So now, how does that relate to the creation-evolution debate?
Okay. If we assume that these ERV sequences are really from a past infection in the germline, and if we assume that the retroviral sequences are inserted essentially randomly, then when we find an ERV sequence that is very similar and in the same position in two different animals, it would make sense that this came from an infection that happened in one of their ancestors.
Okay.
So the evolutionists were really excited when they found out that humans and other primates share similar ERV sequences in the same position.
Yes, they were.
To them, that was proof that humans and other primates had to share a common ancestor.
Mm-hmm.
It seemed that's the best way to explain it.
Right. Okay. Now, I like the way Dr. Joseph Mastropolo put it. I mean, typically a virus infects a specific type of cell or area in the DNA. So you and I getting the same flu does not make us relatives.
True enough. And that is a good point. Perhaps those sequences got there independently in humans and primates.
Okay. So now, what are some of the problems with this thinking that ERVs are, in fact, evidence of a viral infection, and more importantly, evidence of evolution?
Okay. As I mentioned, ERVs are believed to be junk DNA. If ERVs were left over from an ancient viral infection, then certainly they wouldn't be expected to carry out important functions.
Right.
The problem is that more recent research has shown that these portions of DNA are transcribed at specific times in specific tissues. They appear to be important in a number of different ways. There's an excellent creationist article highlighting this. In 2009, Dr. Liu and Dr. Soper published an interesting article in the Answers Research Journal. It was called The Natural History of Retroviruses, Exogenization versus Endogenization. Big words there. Anyhow, in it, they cite research documenting ERVs directly coding for proteins and others associated with gene regulation, DNA repair and recombination, and transduction. Now, transduction is making copies onto RNA and then reverse transcribing them somewhere else in DNA, either in the same cell or maybe in a different cell.
Okay, thank you.
Basically, in this paper, they hypothesized that things went the other direction. Retroviruses appeared when these mobile elements escaped from the genome.
Okay.
So they were in the genome first.
Oh, okay. So in other words, ERVs weren't caused by virus genes, but rather the virus genes came from ERVs.
Yeah, that's what it appears like. One of the biggest problems for the earlier claims that these are evidence for evolution is that ERVs have been shown to have essential roles in reproduction and development. So, how did the primate ancestor reproduce while it was waiting for the germline retroviral infection?
Yeah, it brings whole new meaning to "honey, I don't have a headache." I mean, this is a critical point. This is the reproductive system. So, effectively, without this alleged ERV, no reproduction, therefore extinction of the species.
It would certainly seem so. Okay, instead of these sequences being the result of ancient infection, it seems more logical that they were created for a purpose. And the article by Liu and Soper make a very good case for this.
Okay.
Now, I mentioned earlier two assumptions. The first assumption is that the sequences were the result of germline infections in the distant past, and we've just discussed why this may not be the case. The second is that they are randomly inserted in the genome. Mm-hmm. Well, there's a more recent article by Santoni et al. That challenges this. Not only did they find a human ERV associated with an essential part of development, but they also found that the placement of these sequences were associated with certain epigenetic markers.
Okay, so now, if I may interrupt you for a split second there, for the sake of the viewers, epigenetics is sort of controlling of genes with other genetic switches, which are called epigenetic markers. So just think of epigenetic markers as switches that turn on or off certain portions of the DNA. Sorry, Gene, I just had to throw something in to make myself look smart here. carry on with what you were saying.
Okay. Yeah, in this case, the epigenetic markers are a specific histone. Mm-hmm. And a histone's a special protein that the DNA is wrapped around, and it affects how much it is exposed, and how much it's exposed affects how much it's translated.
Okay.
So anyhow, the Santoni et al. Paper indicates that this type of ERV in humans is less randomly arranged than we had thought.
Okay.
You know, sometimes the word random just means we don't understand what the pattern is yet.
Okay.
Now, there are times where ERVs are associated with disease. In fact, we often discover the problems associated with something before we really understand the importance of that something. This was true with bacteria. Because many were found initially associated with disease, many people had assumed that they were all bad.
Right.
But it turns out this is not the case. Most are not harmful. In fact, a lot of them are essential for life on Earth.
Yes.
And I think that this may end up being true of ERVs as well.
Okay. Well, that is fascinating, Dr. Lightner. I really appreciate your taking the time to be on the show today. I know the viewers all appreciate it, too. So for all of us, thank you for being with us and sharing today.
Okay. Thank you for having me.
Stick around. We'll be right back after this break that is so short, your viruses won't even have a chance to get you infected. Thank you.